calling is this idea that there's something more to life, to your life. I would talk to people and they would say, I'm doing this, but what I really want to be doing is this. And so there is just this universal sense that who I am and what I do are not the same thing. And so I think of a calling as your life's work. It's why you're here. Maybe it's your job, maybe it's not. But if you die without answering the calling, right? If you end your life without doing this thing, whatever it is, the thing that's on your heart, the thing that you feel like is inside of you that wants to get out into the world, something is going to feel incomplete. This idea that I've got important work to do in this world, and if I don't do it, nobody will do it, that's a calling. I'm Jeff Goins. I write books and help other writers through online courses. I knew that I wanted to be a writer, I don't know, a long, long time ago. I think most dreams, you get them early on, then you forget them, then you remember them. So the first time I knew was probably when I was a kid, writing short stories and making my own comic books when I don't know, I was 10, 11 years old. And then at some point I kind of forgot that and remembered it probably when I was around 27. And I started a blog and I started sharing my writing with the world and people started to listen and connect with it. And I thought maybe I could do something with it. I love connecting ideas with people. And for me, when I sit down to write, I'm hoping that it reaches someone. And so when people send me letters, send me emails saying, when I read that line in that book, when I read that blog post or that podcast, when you said this thing at that event, that was for me. I love that. It's exciting, fun work. The biggest challenge of this journey for me has been really knowing what I want and being okay with wanting something that doesn't sound particularly exciting or ambitious to someone else. And I think it was in 2015 where I got all these things that I thought I wanted. Made more money than I ever thought I'd make, had a best-selling book, did all these things. And by the end of the year, I just kind of still felt like me. I thought I'd be a different person, I'd feel different, and it was disappointing. And what I realized I'd been doing was chasing other people's definitions of success. Certain amount of money, certain amount of fame. All those things are fine, but I was doing what I thought was expected of me. And it didn't make me happy. And so the biggest challenge for me has been to not chase something just because everybody else is chasing it. Hustling just because everybody else is hustling. And never being content with where you're at. It seems to be a cool thing to do, and it's never made me happy. One of the biggest myths about this is that you just know. You just know. You know what you're supposed to do. Some people just know. A lot of people I found don't know. And I ended up interviewing hundreds of people who had discovered their life's work and asked them, how did you just know? And they all said the same thing. I didn't. I had an idea, I had a thought, I had an itch that I needed to scratch, but I didn't just know. I started moving in a direction and at one point I committed to it, I picked it, I went for it, and it worked out, right? When you are about to do something big, most of us are shaking in our boots when we're making those decisions, and that's okay. There's a great amount of comfort when you realize most of us don't just know, but we act anyway. So the book Real Artists Don't Starve was inspired, probably the way most books are for me, by conversations. I kept talking to two different groups of people. I live in Nashville, very creative hub. You got a lot of musicians, a lot of aspiring authors, creative entrepreneurs, and it continues to grow in that. And they would either tell me one of two stories. The first story was, man, things are great. This is amazing. I can't believe I get to make a living doing this. And then there's this other group of people that I would meet and they would go, man, I'm struggling, I'm hustling, it's just not working out because, you know, there's no money in art. Well, you can't make any money, you know, as an artist, as a musician, as a writer, right? I go, well, you can if that's what you think. And it was just so fascinating because you have two groups of people telling two very different stories about the same thing. And so I wanted to write a book about that. And as I was thinking about that, I kind of want to introduce these two groups of people to each other. Starving artists meet thriving artists. It is possible. You don't have to starve. That's the message of the book. And I call that the new renaissance. So there are lots of people, lots of thriving artists who are making a new path, a new way for the next generations, next generation of creative professionals. I met an artist, a visual artist, a painter in Indianapolis, and he does a painting a day, but he prices his art cheaply enough that, you know, anybody who has a little bit of cash that cares about art can put an indie landscape painting in their house, puts it on Instagram, sells two or three paintings a day. He's making, you know, a couple hundred grand a year. The fine artists in Indianapolis hate him because fine art is expensive. You do galleries and, you know, these serious paintings have to be between $5,000 and $10,000 a piece. And they'll do these galleries and sell one or two paintings every 6 months. He does a gallery, 120 paintings, $200 to $500 a piece, sells out in two nights. They hate him because he's thinking like an entrepreneur. He's thinking about supply and demand. He goes, I don't care. I'll paint a $400 painting. It doesn't matter to me. I said, how did you get so successful? He said, math. He said, I realized the ideal price per square inch of a canvas. I go, people like that. I mean, they think differently. They don't think about their art necessarily as this precious thing that I hope somebody pays me for someday. They go, I'm gonna make this thing, and then how can I make it relevant to other people? How can I find a market for it? So one of the things that I've learned about all this stuff is people are afraid of failure. I think sometimes we think fear is a bad thing, and you shouldn't feel afraid, and don't feel bad. It doesn't work anyway. You still feel afraid. But I don't think fear is necessarily a bad thing. There's good fear. The bad fear is the kind that says, if you do this, you might fail. Okay, that's not helpful. But the good fear is the kind that says, if you don't do this, will you regret this? Will you regret not having tried? Because you're not guaranteed success. But that's not where the fun part is anyway. The fun is in the climb, the journey, the chasing of it, not just the attaining of it. And so if I could say one thing, it would be don't be afraid of failure. Be more afraid of not trying.